Good morning, everybody. It's my pleasure to introduce Bishop McNeill, who's the manager for the Freethought Equality Fund and the political coordinator for the Center for Freethought Equality. He runs AI's PAC. And he's going to present a talk called The Humanist Movement and the Democratic Growth of Nonreligious Africans. Americans. And please welcome Bishop McNeill. Thank you.
Thank you so much for that introduction. As she said, my name is Bishop McNeill, and I am the political coordinator and the PAC manager of the Center for Freethought Equality and the Freethought Equality Fund. Just to clear up something real quick, I am not a Catholic bishop. I'm not an Episcopalian bishop or any kind of religious bishop. I am an atheist, and that just happens to be my name, which is rather ironic, but it's a good starting point to have some good conversations. And so I just wanted to clear that up because I've had a lot of people come up to me and ask me about that. So I'm originally from North Carolina. Please don't boo. I've been very active in politics for years in North Carolina, working on political campaigns and within the Democratic Party. I moved to D.C. 3 years ago to work with the PAC, and recently moved back to North Carolina. And somebody asked me, you know, why would you want to move back to a state that's so backwards? And my response was, well, I want to go where I'm most needed. You know, we can stay in our confines of our, you know, safe spaces or, you know, our liberal areas, but, you know, where we're most needed, where progressive democratic activists are needed, I think, is in the South. And to really try to turn the tide that's, reverse the tide that's going, you know, backwards forward for progressive politics. And so I hope to do that, you know, again while I'm in North Carolina, and hopefully we can reverse some of the negative trends that we're seeing. So the title of my talk today is The Humanist Movement and the Demographic Growth of Nonreligious Americans. You know, as we continue to see the polling and survey results that show an increasing trend of both acceptance of nonreligious candidates and the growing demographic of those that are not religiously affiliated, how can secular and humanist organizations capitalize on this from a political perspective? So we'll look at some recent victories by humanist candidates. I'll talk a little about the polling that has shown growth in America's acceptance of atheist candidates, the prospects of electing an atheist president one day, some problems that exist with the current presidential debate structure, and finally, we'll look at the results from the Political Pulse of Secular America survey that was conducted by the Center for Freethought Equality. So the Center for Freethought Equality is an adjunct organization of the American Humanist Association dedicated to lobbying and political advocacy. Since 2010, the Center for Freethought Equality has significantly increased humanist activity in key Washington coalitions and has established a permanent lobbyist on the Hill that is fighting for issues secular Americans care about, like the separation of church and state and protecting civil liberties. Since coming on board in 2013, the organization has grown from having a purely lobbying agenda to now having over 15,000 members that can support the only political action committee within the secular movement, which is the Freethought Equality Fund. While I also lead the development and political activities of the CFE, my primary role is managing the electoral fundraising, distribution of funds, and the independent expenditure strategy for the Political Action Committee. The mission of the Freethought Equality Fund is to change the face of American politics by increasing the number of openly humanist and atheist candidates at all levels of public office. You know, to achieve this mission, our goal in 2016 has been simple but focused. It's to find a candidate that will become the face of our movement, that we can promote to voters, the media, and supporters like those in this audience as a credible, openly humanist candidate running in a winnable congressional district. Well, on April 26, Jamie Raskin, a member of the American Humanist Association, endorsed by the Freethought Equality Fund, won a very competitive race in a crowded field of candidates in Maryland's 8th Congressional District. In this heavily Democratic district, Raskin is expected to easily win the general election on November 8th. This is a view of the congratulatory ad that we ran on the Hill and in congressional roll call. And we did some online promotion of this that received over 500,000 impressions and over 1,000 shares on Facebook and social media. And so we were getting the word out about this historic moment, really for humanism and really for progressive politics. And so that's what you'll see in this on this picture. So like it says, if successful, which he will be, Raskin will be the first humanist to ever win an open seat and just the second open humanist to ever serve in Congress. I reiterate open because we know that there's probably been a lot of more people who identify as humanists, but they have been too afraid to come out as such. You know, his election is significant for the secular community and will help to dispel the baseless bias against this rapidly growing segment of America. Raskin has earned this victory with his highly respected public service and his grassroots campaigning. To be clear, the American Humanist Association defines humanism as a progressive philosophy of life that, without theism and other supernatural beliefs, affirms our ability and responsibility to leave ethical lives of personal fulfillment that aspire to the greater good of humanity. Despite some confusion following the victory, Raskin has not backed away from this definition of humanism, but he felt it was important to acknowledge his cultural Jewish background when articles were written that used the label atheist. Raskin hasn't publicly denied that he is a non-believer, but he will not publicly accept that label either, as it's his view that it's more important to talk about what he does believe in than what he doesn't. His commitment to the secular community was solidified recently with the announcement of Raskin speaking at the Reason Rally next week, a relationship that the Freethought Equality Fund facilitated months ago. This was influenced by the almost $50,000 in support directly from the PAC and another $15,000 estimated that was raised from secular donors across the country, many of whom are in this room today. Raskin plans to advance his progressive policies in the U.S. Congress as he did as a Maryland state senator. In Annapolis, he led four floor fights to recognize same-sex marriage, to repeal the death penalty, to ban the shackling of pregnant prisoners in labor, and legalize medical marijuana. As a renowned professor of constitutional law, Raskin is also one of the nation's leading advocates for reason in government, science-based public policy, and the separation of church and state. Raskin received national notice from the progressive and secular community in 2006 when he testified in favor of marriage equality. Senator Nancy Jacobs said the Bible reserved marriage for a man and a woman. Raskin responded by saying, "When you took your oath of office, you placed your hand on the Bible and swore to uphold the Constitution. You did not place your hand on the Constitution and swear to uphold the Bible." And also, while accepting a Distinguished Service Award by the AHA in 2008, Raskin had this to say: "Has it gotten so edgy out there that those of us in public life are afraid to be associated with the great tradition of philosophical and ethical humanism? Do we actually have to whisper about the fact that many Americans still identify with the Enlightenment values of our founders and refuse to organize their political thoughts according to sectarian religious dogma? I vowed to show up in person so people could see at least one other elected official besides the great U.S. Representative Pete Stark who isn't afraid to utter the H word in public." You know, I can only imagine, I'm sure many of you can only imagine, you know, where the current discourse of American politics would be if these statements were made on the floor of the House of Representatives. Well, due to the support of many in this room, we have the opportunity to make this vision a reality in 2016. The successful election of an openly humanist candidate to Congress will greatly reduce the false perception that you have to loudly proclaim your religious beliefs in order to get elected. This in turn will help us encourage other politicians that we know are in the closet to come out and to convince other non-theist candidates to run openly as such. We've also seen some victories on the state level by openly secular political candidates so far in 2016. Three Oregon State House candidates endorsed by the Freethought Equality Fund handily won their Democratic primary elections recently, and they are Julie Fahey, Diego Hernandez, and Pam Marsh. Julie Fahey is running in Oregon's 14th State House district. and won her primary with over 60% of the vote. Fahey, who doesn't identify with any religion, believes critical thinking and science can best help us understand our world. Her public policy decisions will be guided by evidence and a rational approach to decision making, rather than by dogma or religious beliefs. Diego Hernandez is seeking election to Oregon's 47th State House District and won his primary with nearly 70% of the vote. Hernandez, who was raised Catholic, is now agnostic. He is a strong supporter of the separation of church and state and believes that public policy should be subject to argument and amenable to reason. Pam Marsh ran unopposed in the Democratic primary for Oregon's 5th State House District. She is not affiliated with any religious organization and believes that one religious views are irrelevant to public policy. So by demonstrating that politicians can win elections without professing religious beliefs, this election is very encouraging for the Freethought Equality Fund and the secular community. These candidates will now advance to the general election on November 8th, where, you know, they're likely to win because of the history of these districts. You know, they're very heavily Democratic and they have elected Democratic representatives in the past. In other secular election news this month, Nebraska State Senator Ernie Chambers won his nonpartisan primary election with over 73% of the vote. In the general election, Chambers will face the candidate who placed second, who only received 18% of the vote. Chambers is the longest-serving state senator in the history of Nebraska, and he is a hero in the secular community for his attempts to end state-sponsored chaplain legislative prayers in the Supreme Court case Marsh versus Chambers, and his 2007 legal action to protest frivolous and inappropriate lawsuits seeking a permanent injunction against God's harmful activities. Senator Chambers is receiving the American Humanist Association's Lifetime Achievement Award for his outstanding service and commitment to secular government. So, in the United States, it is it's generally assumed that the political atmosphere is so hostile toward the secular and non-religious community that, you know, simply identifying as a humanist is, or while running for office, is political suicide. We really can't rely on nationwide public perceptions. Only the data can really inform us of the electability of a particular candidate. So what do the numbers tell us about these candidates running for public office? Well, the first piece of evidence to suggest that a humanist may not have as much trouble winning an election is the general trend of a Gallup poll that first asked this question in 1937. The survey asked respondents to indicate whether they would vote for a qualified individual based on certain identifiers, an atheist being one of them. In 2007, only 45% of Americans said that they would vote for an atheist. In 2012, that number grew to 54%. And in a recent 2015 report showed that 58% of Americans now saying that they would vote for an atheist as president. But don't get too excited. We may be years away from electing an atheist president, but this data is encouraging on a congressional level. You see, these numbers average in Americans from different regions, political affiliations, and different ages. And all of these affect people's acceptance of atheist candidates. For example, 64% of Democrats and 61% of independents say that they would support an atheist for president, while only 45% of Republicans said the same. Now let's look at the regional difference. A state like Mississippi in the South has 61% of people saying that they are very religious, while on the other end, a northeastern state like Vermont has 56% of people saying that they're not religious at all. Now those are the extremes on both ends, but there are clear regional differences in terms of the religiosity of voters. The final piece of evidence suggests that not too long from now, a large majority of Americans would support non-religious candidates for president, with 75% of people age 18 to 30 saying that they would, that the person's religious beliefs wouldn't matter at all to them. Now, all of this should be very encouraging that, slowly but surely, the secular community in America is becoming more accepted in politics, especially in areas with high Democratic voter registration, less religiosity, and a younger than average population. So as you can see, 2016 has already given us some major victories to be proud of. But what about the prospects of electing an atheist president one day? Can you imagine this oath when the United States' first atheist president is inaugurated? I do solemnly affirm that I will faithfully execute the office of President of the United States and will, to the best of my ability, preserve, protect, and defend the Constitution of the United States. So help me, Darwin. You know, the so help me part is actually not required. And I can hardly imagine a day anytime soon when references to God will be replaced by Charles Darwin. You know, but could you imagine the openly atheist president taking the oath while placing his hand on the U.S. Constitution, the very document that they are swearing and affirming to preserve and protect? I hope so, too. So only two U.S. presidents, Theodore Roosevelt and John Quincy Adams, chose not to place their hand on the Bible when being sworn in. It's unknown why Roosevelt refused to take the oath, but according to a 2013 CNN report by lawyer turned political media Dean Abdallah, Adams chose to be sworn in with his hand on the book of U.S. laws. He wanted to demonstrate that he recognized a barrier between church and state, and his loyalty was to our nation's laws above anything else. You know, I imagine that many believers doubt that they will, the likelihood of seeing an atheist president in their lifetime. You know, perhaps in a similar way to how many African Americans pre-2008, you know, thought that they would ever see a black president in their lifetime. You know, but how far are we actually from actually, you know, this being a reality? You know, well, there's some encouraging news for the humanist movement. In that most recent study released by Gallup in 2015, atheists are actually no longer at the bottom of the list in terms of acceptance. It turns out Americans distrust socialists more. Sorry, Bernie. You know, but what does it say, you know, when a well-known socialist and more than likely a closeted atheist like Bernie Sanders has given the Democratic frontrunner Hillary Clinton more of a run than anyone expected in 2016? The most recent polling, along with those showing that roughly 1 in 5 people in this country identify as non-religious, are relevant when thinking about an openly atheist president. The United States is clearly becoming less religious, but more importantly, these studies show that as more and more Americans are choosing to live openly without religion, those who are religious are also becoming more accepting of the non-religious in the general public, as well as in the political world. That is what's really important in terms of growing the trust that's needed to elect an atheist president. So what might an atheist president do on the first day in the Oval Office? They might make Darwin Day a federal holiday and do away with the National Day of Prayer. That'd be good. Or they might disband the Congressional Prayer Caucus in the House of Representatives. Or, you know, they maybe call for the removal of In God We Trust on our currency and on government buildings. Okay. Well, an atheist president probably wouldn't pursue these issues on the first day or even in their first term, but they might as a lame duck, you know, if they were bold enough. We could all hope, right? You know, the fact is that the atheist president wouldn't act all that differently than previous ones in this sense. U.S. presidents are limited in what they can do by Congress. And secondly, the United States will likely still be a majority religious country when a non-believer takes office. You know, there seems to be this belief that in order to elect an atheist, America needs to not be religious at all, or at least the nuns have to be a majority. I don't think that that's true. When we finally elect an atheist president, he or she will have the same responsibility to represent religious Americans as a religious president has to represent atheists. Yes, they could be the first to take an oath on the U.S. Constitution, which would be great to see, but more importantly, an atheist president will finally honor the oath to preserve and protect the Constitution, which starting with the First Amendment principle of a separation of church and state. So finally, I want to talk about a little bit about the 2016 presidential election. I don't have much time, but I'll try to rush through this. Over the past several months, we've gotten a sense of how the presidential elections are shaping up, at least for the primary. You know, we've seen the candidates at their podiums feeding red meat to their bases. We've seen the political ads by super PACs and special interest groups touting their preferred candidate's record or getting the lead on the negative attacks that we'll likely see more of in the months ahead. You know, and we've also borne witness to the presidential debates that have captivated millions of people who want to see if candidates will give brilliant answers on tough policy questions or say something stupid that would go viral online and become the talk of media pundits. But what have we learned? But have we learned anything about these candidates that would cause a big shift in the election results? The data doesn't reflect this, even though there have been some moderate shift in the public favor at this point. A big argument of the debate structure, you know, for the GOP was that there were too many candidates and not enough time on the big stage to get a good idea of what their positions are. The argument from the left is that the Democratic National Committee wants Hillary Clinton to be the nominee and is thus limiting the number of debates while also nudging other candidates to not go too negative against her. You know, there are definite merits to both of these arguments, but what is the solution to ensure that voters, you know, truly get to the heart of a candidate's position on public policy? One of the solutions could be changing the structure of all debates, especially during the primary season, to single-issue forums. It's said that this type of political discourse is impossible in our rigid two-party system that forces individuals to, in many cases, make a lesser of two evils decision on who they want to vote for. This is a valid argument against you know, two-party political systems, but I don't think we'll see that change anytime soon. You know, this really inspired the Center for Freethought Equality to conduct a survey called the Political Pulse of Secular America. The purpose of the survey was to help our movement determine not only which presidential candidates the secular community favors, but also what issues are more important to us. The goal was to learn more about the secular community's thoughts and opinions on national politics to be in a better position to advocate for them in the future. The survey was open for responses for 21 days and was promoted on social media, blogs, and email communications, as well as by many different groups, writers, and leaders within the secular community. In total, over 2,400 people responded to this survey. So here are some of the results. 58% are affiliated with the Democratic Party, and 41% think of themselves as independents. Of those independents, 45% view themselves as closer to the Democrats, while only 2% view themselves closer to Republicans. 83% are at least very interested in national politics, with 56% saying they have contributed money to political campaigns or PACs in the past. 76% believe the country is heading in the right direction and approve at least a moderate amount of the job that President Barack Obama is doing. 74% would vote for Bernie Sanders for president if the election were held today, 21% for Hillary Clinton, and 2% for Donald Trump. I don't know who those 2% were, but I don't know. 35% say that the separation of church and state is one of the top three most important issues, but respondents rank this behind economy and jobs, healthcare, and climate change overall. 41% believe that science education and research funding is the most important secular issue the next president should address. So it's very important that people form their own interpretation of what the broader implications of these surveys are, but I think some are clear. For starters, the secular community is not only overwhelmingly supporting Bernie Sanders for president, they are also at least moderately enthusiastic about their choices. Secondly, this is just another piece of evidence that shows how the rise of secular Americans greatly benefits the Democratic Party, which is a fact that organizations like the Center for Freethought Equality is going to be sure that we make them aware of. Finally, just like every minority group in this country, the secular community, for the most part, is not monolithic in the issues we care most about. Sure, we care more about separation of church and state than the average voter, but just like the average voter, we care more about having a job, getting health, quality health care, and ensuring that our environment is habitable for future generations to come. These recent victories and the growth of the secular demographic didn't come by us sitting on the sidelines and waiting for change. It happened by us rolling up our sleeves, working hard, and doing all in our power to support these candidates and to not be afraid to be openly secular ourselves. We see the tactics of those on the other side who, in the name of religion, will try to block this progress. We also understand that there is still so much more work ahead of us. But for the undue influence of fundamentalist religion is completely removed from public policy decision making. Religious freedom should not be a valid excuse to discriminate, period. We've seen these attempts countless times just in the past year, from Kentucky Clerk Kim Davis refusing to issue marriage license, which led to several state legislatures pushing for the allowance of conscious objections based on religious beliefs, to the most recent attempts by lawmakers in North Carolina trying to legislate who can use what bathroom. This has to stop, but it will only stop if communities like ours are politically active and we understand the importance of financial influence in politics. I know some, if not many of us, are fed up with money in politics, but there is too much at stake for us to be completely idealistic about this. We have to think practically and work within the confines of the system we have to at least try to advocate for and influence public policy based on our humanist values. Thank you so much. So I'll take any questions anybody might have on the discussion and any generic questions. Go ahead.
The growth of the nuns or the non-affiliated is certainly, I think, very significant and important, but it's my understanding that that phenomenon in and of itself doesn't necessarily mean that that shift in demographics implies, I mean, it's an escape from maybe traditional religion, but that doesn't necessarily mean that these people are either non-religious in the broader sense, or more pertinently, that they are non-theist. Right. Could you comment?
No, I think that that's exactly right. You know, when we see the numbers 1 in 5, you know, it's still, you know, non-believers are still only, I think, 5% of that number. And many of those people are not affiliated with any organized religion. And also when we look at these polls, you know, even people who identify as religious are getting tired of the overly religious rhetoric in politics. And so I think that's what's important in terms of the shift in mentality of people who are really getting fed up, regardless of their beliefs, of too much religion in politics. And I think that's what's important.
All right. Peter Anderson from Orange County, California.
Hey.
There was a Pew Research study about a year ago talking about what the religious landscape was going to look like worldwide in 50 years or so, or by 2050. Are you familiar with that?
Somewhat.
Yeah, they're actually forecasting a decline in secular population worldwide by 2050. Big growth in Muslim population, I guess, and kind of a decline in secular. So it's a little bit discouraging, but we've got work to do, I guess.
Yeah, well, I think that it may be discouraging on a global level, but I think all the evidence shows that, you know, here in the United States, the trends are in the favor of less religious identity in the future. So I think here in the U.S., that's not necessarily that accurate. But
I hear that the millennials are more than 50% non-religious, and it appears to me the millennials are leading our new generations.
No, yes. Like I mentioned, in the Gallup poll, 75% of people age 18 to 30 said that a person's religion wouldn't affect their decisions at all. And so, you know, we can only imagine 10, 15, 20 years, you know, when these people get more active in the political process and have money to be able to give to political campaigns, that we'll see, you know, even more of a growth on terms of acceptance of atheist candidates. So, you know, I don't think that it's, you know, I still think we have far to go, but it's not as far as I think many people think it is. So.
Thank you for your talk. Just a note, in Minnesota, where I'm from, we had a Day of Reason event. It was small, maybe only 40 people, but we were at the state capitol and we had invited the legislators. And we had 3 that showed up this year. We do this with the Minnesota Atheists as well. Mm-hmm. And one has shown up for many years, but does it sort of out of respect. But 2 showed up this year, 2 additional ones showed up this year, and specifically mentioned humanism and standing with, you know, reason and critical thinking. And so that was really, they're already in elected office, and I don't know if they would run on identifying with us, but they were there, and it was really wonderful.
No, that's great, yeah.
But my question is more to the issue kind of again of language. And I think it's representative of what you were finding out, is humanists really we're voting on our values, not just the fact that most of us are atheists, right. But we're voting on our values. Right. And in terms of your work, what are you finding in terms of people identifying more as a humanist candidate or atheist or secular? Like, what language are you using, and what do you think is best in terms of promoting our views in public policy?
No, I think that that's a very good question. Each candidate is, we have to treat as an individual, and you know, some have more trepidations about being very stringent with the language that they use, and it's calling himself a non-believer and atheist. And some, like you said, like Jamie Raskin, wants to focus more on what he does believe in than what he doesn't. But he is committed to political discourse and actions that are based on our humanist values. And I think that that's what's really important. We try to focus on that because, I mean, saying that you're an atheist doesn't tell me how you're going to vote on particular issues. I mean, it doesn't. And so it's important that we have a list of values that, you know, the humanist community really cares about. And, you know, we send out questionnaires to ask candidates, you know, how do you align on these issues? And we don't endorse anybody who's not, you know, almost 100% in line with the humanist values that AHA and other organizations, you know, really advocate for. So we really try to focus on that. Yeah.
Okay, we have time for one more question.
I was curious if you were familiar with Steve Hill, who is running for a Senate seat in California, who's not only atheist, but affiliated with the Satanic Temple. Mm-hmm. And if there has been any work to maybe promote his campaign on the part of your organization.
So Steve Hill is a good friend of mine, and I have been speaking with him. You know, when he first ran for state senate, he ran as a write-in candidate, and I believe in 2012, and now he's running again. He's very passionate about really stoking the fire and not being afraid to push people off and to really, you know, be an unabashedly, you know, atheist. And you know, we, the organization, the PAC, really tries to be more mainstream in our focus, and so his association with the Satanic Temple is not necessarily a deal breaker, but at the same time, we have to think practically. And so, like I said, you know, in politics, especially campaigns, we sometimes have to put our idealism to the side and think practically. And so that's what decision that we made in not endorsing and supporting Steve Hill. And we also look at the chances of a candidate winning, which factors in. While I think that he's a great guy, I just don't think that he has a great chance of winning. But that's my honest opinion on that. So I appreciate your question, though.
All righty. Thank you so much for your time. Everybody enjoy lunch.